Hi, everyone, and welcome to episode 3 of Coloring Outside the Box. I have to admit that this is my second attempt because somehow I was trying out my new microphone and it went on mute. So welcome to Leslie's Adventures with Technology, which isn't really the subject of this podcast, but it's sort of the natural place for me to start because normally, under these circumstances, I would feel like life was stepping on my very last nerve, and I would respond in kind. So, and now before you're blinded by whatever's in my glasses, I'm going to take them off. Anyway, so on that slightly amusing note, we can get started because that's too constraining. That's too much like a box. The thread or the starting point for today's podcast is really looking at how we are currently feeling. And most of us are feeling like life is stepping on the very last nerve that we have. We wonder if we have the capacity to adapt to any more uncertainty. Anymore, what seems to be a lack of knowledge about what really is going on. Because, of course, every day we hear someone say something that seems completely contradictory to what we've been told the day before about the current world situation. And this, of course, pushes all our buttons and makes us wonder if anybody knows what's going on. And the difficult thing may be to recognize that maybe nobody actually knows what's going on, at least in the broader context. So again, not only do we feel constrained and restrained and boxed in and sometimes imprisoned by our current set of circumstances, but we've always for so long come to depend on news, the web, there is more information out there than we actually know what to do with. And some of it's factual and some of it's opinion. And we've come to depend on that to be able to tell us what's happening in our world. And now we are faced with the reality that this situation is ever-changing and is so, how shall I put it, uncontained, the word's not coming, that in itself is causing us a tremendous amount of stress, if not downright fear. So one of the things I'm going to say right now is that I find myself thinking about my great-grandparents. And, you know, because I live in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada, and they came here in the early 1900s. And in those days, as my kids would say, there wasn't the plethora of information that we have today. And so we do need to realize that we have come to so profoundly depend on knowing what's going on by always consulting outside sources. And I know myself, I have stopped watching coverage in any detail because after a while I realized that we really don't know what's happening. Yeah, we can have the numbers of people who've been infected and the number of people who've died, but we still really don't know what's happening every single day. And if we get hung up on that and attach to that, then we're putting the capacity to take charge of our lives outside ourselves. So and that doesn't mean that's happening. What's happening in the greater world is not of importance. It's just a framework, though. It doesn't, and it shouldn't necessarily define how you live your life every day outside of honoring and respecting the things that have been put in place to protect us. And we may feel that those are unreasonable and unnecessary. And we're never going to know whether that's true. We cannot go backwards. And this is one of the challenges that we face right now, is because we feel like we can't go forwards. Some of us, we feel that if we go backwards and figure out exactly what happened and why and all that, it's going to change how we feel about what's happening. And it probably won't. So where does this leave us? Where does it leave you and me? I often joke that I've been practicing for COVID-19 for a while, because for the last number, I'm a writer. I see clients. My home is my office. It's my entertainment space. It's my business. It's my everything. And so I spend quite a lot of time here. And so initially, I did not feel that this was going to be a challenge for me. But as soon as somebody told me I couldn't go somewhere, I really wanted to go. So I understand why we all feel that somehow our lives have been irrevocably changed and we don't like it. Which of course leads me to one of my favorite ways of looking at things, which is, as humans, we often don't like things. And you don't have to like this. Nobody asking you to, I'm certainly not asking you to like it. However, part of being pragmatic and realistic is accepting that this is true, that we are in some measure of lockdown. And it may be we needed, the powers that be needed to find some different languaging. I often find that in the US, since I'm Canadian, I found that shelter in place sounded a little bit more attractive. It may not feel more attractive, but it maybe sounded a little more attractive. Anyways, I digress. So what are we going to do as we feel like life is standing on our very last nerve? And we just want to rebel, resist, come out fighting, do something to bring things to a place where we feel comfortable and safe. And it's really hard to accept that for the time being, that is probably not going to happen. That we are going to have to continue. Well, we don't have to. I hesitate to say that we have to do anything. It might be important if we want to relieve our stress, because that is important. The more stressed you are, the more challenged your physical body is. So in each and every day, as we get up and deal with our personal reality, we need to find a way to lighten our load. So I just want to ask yourself, what does that feel like to you? Right now, that feels impossible, right? There are lots of days it's like, oh my God, like, how long is this going to go on for? We'd all like it if we knew that next Friday at 4 o'clock, or better yet, even yesterday at 4 o'clock, that everything went back to normal, to a world that we understand, to a world that we know. Now, I think it's important that sometimes we realize that maybe that's a bit of an illusion. This notion, this romantic notion, this nostalgic notion that the life we had 3 months ago was better than this. Because before COVID-19 came along, it's a problem that has impacted most of the planet. However, there are always things on the planet that impact large numbers of people. So why is this different? The reason why it's different is because on some level we understand that we are at a major turning point in human history. Now, I can easily say that and not be able to tell you exactly what I think that is or what it means or where what it's going to be actually. It's just a feeling. You know, that old Chinese proverb, may you live in interesting times. We do live in interesting times. And I think that to some degree, we may have been lulled into a false sense of complacency based on our capacity over the last 150 to 60, maybe 170 years, to begin to feel like we were in charge, we humans were in charge of everything. Because we've progressed so much industrially, technologically, and so we must be, how shall I put it? Inviolable, that we're in power, that we're in charge. And then along comes a virus and reminds us that we don't live in a vacuum apart from the rest of the planet that we live on. The trees, the grass, and that we live in a microcosm and a macrocosm simultaneously, and that the human microcosm is not in charge of the macrocosm, that we are a part of it, that we live as a part of it, and that perhaps we need not to be quite as self-satisfied as we humans have a tendency to be. Now, if that sounds critical, I don't mean it to be. Life is always uncertain, and humans are always trying to find a way to survive and to thrive. And fortunately for us, we've been thriving. And we will thrive again. And even in these circumstances, there are parts of us that can thrive, even if we can't, travel to other parts of the world, do the things that we have been doing in the past, that what we can create coming out of this could be more beautiful, more profound, deeper, sorry about that, something binged. We humans have always, over the course of our history, created beauty out of the most difficult circumstances. We have risen to the challenge of what it means to confront all sorts of difficulties, tragedies, chaos, even cruelty. And that we have within us, each and every one of us, the capacity to really be present and find creative solutions. One of the things we keep seeing on the news, or on Facebook or in other places, are the things that people are creating and doing in the middle of all of this. So for instance, I wondered, should I start a podcast in the middle of a pandemic? Is this a good time to be talking about compassion, creativity, passion, purpose, when everybody feels like there's nothing that they can do, that they're at the mercy of something over which they have no control? And of course, I talked to close friends about this and realized that the best thing I could do is to do something that brings me joy, that allows me to do one of my favorite things, which is to share, to stimulate conversation. You know, when I get a little bit more comfortable with this whole thing, I will be hopefully doing some live events in which we can engage in a conversation. So it won't be just me talking. Other people will get an opportunity to share themselves. Because I think that's one of the most beautiful things that's coming out of where we're at right now, is people actually sharing their stories and others being willing to listen. Because, you know, communication isn't just about talking. Sometimes people think that if they can talk, they can communicate. No, because communication is as much about listening and being present as it is about talking. Communication is both of those things, not just one of those things. And we all get a little hung up because it can sometimes feel like the world doesn't hear us. And I think that is, you can see that in the proliferation of all of the social media tools. People want to be heard because they feel no one's listening. Now, when I say that, I am talking about people's perception and their experience and how they feel, not necessarily what's factually true. You know, some of it, I think, is very much connected to when you're a child. And because you're a child, you know, you're taught that everybody knows more about what's good for you than you do. And so, well, and it wasn't so long ago. I mean, I am part of a generation where the transition was from children should be seen and not heard. I remember going with my dad to visit his favorite aunt and being told that my sister and I both being told before we went that we, you know, that would really make him happy if we could sit and be good little girls. And of course, because he was our dad, we did exactly that. I guess what I'm trying to say is that for so long, we have been encouraged to allow others to interpret what life is for us and not be willing to listen to our experience. And of course, experience is very much about emotion, about feeling, about what you're actually experiencing. And I'm fond of saying we live on a planet that thinks that emotions are inconvenient at best. And so right now we're in the middle of something where what is the most powerful response we're having on a daily basis? It's an emotional one. It's a feeling one. And we need, you know, people to hear us. We need to be able to speak our truth. And I know that sounds very cliche because it is turning into a cliche. But cliches are often reflective of what is actually true. The question is, do we go beyond turning it into a cliche and actually going through that action? So here we are. What can we do every day as we feel like, yes, I'm going to say it again, that life is standing on our very last nerve? Perhaps we could look inside and ask ourselves why we feel that way. Rather than suppressing the feeling, allow it to be. Part of that feeling may be fear. You know, our body wants to help us let go of stuff that is unhealthy. And it's not that fear is unhealthy all the time. It's just that, okay, in my instance, I've been tested for COVID-19. And I came back negative. However, when I go out, I still wear a mask. Not because I'm afraid, but because I respect others. Because wearing a mask, you know, the first time I put one on, I thought I was going to hyperventilate and pass out because I felt so restricted. I wanted to rip it off and throw it in the garbage. And that, you know, that is a lot of how we're feeling right now, is that exact feeling, like I want to rip this up or tear this up or, you know, just get rid of it because I don't like these feelings. However, if you let those feelings rise up in you and you find a way to release them, maybe you go for a walk, maybe you have a bath, maybe you meditate, just recognize that there is a lot of fear in the air. And that whether we know it or not, we're all connected. Because I believe humans are multi-frequency beings. And so as the planet has been dealing with this, there's a lot of free-floating anxiety around. And some days it's hard not to get up and feel that fear. I know when I, actually it was my doctor suggested that I get a test. And so I called and I got it set up. And a couple of my friends said, so you got the test that you really wanted all along. And I had to stop and I kind of laughed. And I realized it was true. That I was living in fear. And I couldn't tell whether it was my fear or other people's fear because I'm highly psychic. But it didn't really matter because I was experiencing it. And I think that the most important thing we can do is just acknowledge our feelings. And fear is a feeling. So what do we want to do when we are fearful? Our limbic brain says fight, flight, or go numb. And we can see all of those responses around us, and we can probably feel them all inside us, which is why we feel like we just can't take any more, that we have no tolerance at all. And this isn't all the time. I have to say this isn't all the time, because we are all every day going through a number of thoughts, feelings, and emotions about our situation. So the key becomes, can you just allow that to surface? Acknowledge that that's how you feel, honor how you feel, because then you'll be able to let it go and release it. If you suppress the fear, you're just going to overburden your body. So, again, we don't have to like where we're at, and we don't have to greet it with joy or. We can accept it and not like it all at the same time. One of the things I've discovered in the course of my life is that I often have several different feelings about the same thing at the same time. And I often find that's true for my clients. Life is complex. Humans are complex. And so if you think you're going crazy because one minute you're anxious and uptight, and the next minute, you know, you're watching something, or, you know, I've been posting cat videos that make me laugh, and you find yourself laughing at something, you're not schizophrenic, and you're just human. Your body and your consciousness are adapting as best as they can. So, you know, embrace your own experience. You know, part of what I'm talking about is not for you to find a way to, you know, further button yourself down or constrain yourself. It's more about, you know, taking a step back, being honoring and respecting how you feel, and also observing how you feel. Because you can do both of those things at the same time. I know I've done it. Like, I'm one of those people, like, just little things drive me insane. Big things in life, yeah, I'm cool. And I can observe myself getting upset because somehow I managed to squirt ketchup on the floor. And I can start to react and go, I can see this is my, I'm being true to myself. Because we cannot truly, this space and place gives us an opportunity to reflect, to know ourselves better, not to be caught up in what a lovely woman I once did a workshop with, her name is Sandy Queen, you know, be a human being rather than a human doing. Because when we have the opportunity to be, more things open up to us, more opportunities to find things, to discover more creativity, to find space and place for new beginnings inside ourselves, instead of, you know, just continuing to put one foot in front of the other because life demands it. So we don't know what to do when life comes along and says, okay, here you go. What are you going to do with this? What are you going to do with your fear? What are you going to do with the possible loss of someone that you love? What are you going to do with more time on your hands, it seems? It's just more space. It's not so much more time, it's just more space. It's a different kind of space. Think of it that way. You're living in a different space than you were 3 months ago. What can you do with that space? It's a new space. It's an unusual space. It's a challenging space. It's an uncomfortable space. What can you do with it? And how can it help? How can it help you, that space? Because it can. Humans are famous for taking the most difficult of circumstances. I know I keep saying this because I think we need to remind ourselves that being human is a gift and a challenge and an opportunity. So, as each day passes, just ask yourself, what can I do in this day to support myself, to support my family, to support the people around me? And it can be anything. I have a next door neighbor who's making masks. Other people I know are also making masks, all varieties. Others are, you know, taking care of their family and doing what they can for their family. And all those things, you know, they're obvious. Heck, maybe when you get up in the morning, you get in the shower and you sing for the first time. Maybe, you know, there's a song running through your head and you want to listen to it. Listen to your intuition. Let your inner self guide you to the things that give you moments of joy. Because, you know, those are the things that amplify the serotonin in your body, which is going to help you deal with the uncertainty. Constantly living in a space of what I call awfulizing only diminishes your life force. And I'm not saying, you know, be unrealistic, but awfulizing is the, I'm going to think of every terrible thing I could possibly ever think of that might happen to me in any given set of circumstances. I know I've been prone to it myself. I speak from experience. Most of the time when I talk, I'm going to be, even if I don't give you the specifics of the experience, I'm usually talking from my own life experience, which is why I think this, why storytelling is important. I think we've lost the capacity to share the truth of our lives because we're afraid we're going to be judged. We're afraid that it makes us look bad. Rather than, you know, where do we make connection in the stories of our lives. That's where we make connection. Think about your favorite people in your life. Are they not the people that you totally 100% trust? So this is a time for storytelling, you know, and sit down and, you know, for instance, you know, you might want to talk to your kids about the story of your life. I think that storytelling is one of the most important things we can be doing right now, and we see a lot of it. So don't be afraid to share your story with whomever you wish. And that kind of leads me to the fact that if you'd like to share your story with me, I would love to hear from you. And you can reach me at thepathrevealed@outlook.com. And as I collect my thoughts, I'm waiting for divine inspiration. I've discovered that one of the things I'm not always very good at is saying goodbye. But then I realize this isn't goodbye, it's just till the next time. So until the next time. I look forward to sharing more observations and thoughts. And if you have, again, anything that you would like to share, it doesn't even have to be your story. Any thoughts, ideas that you'd like to share or be a jumping off point for this podcast, please feel free to email me. I'd love to hear from you. After all, I've spent most of my life really defining it by connection with others. It took me a long time to connect to myself as a consequence. But anyway, so I'm going to say goodbye. See you next week. Much love, big hugs.